بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الواحد المنعم والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنام وعلى آله الكرام وصحبه العظام وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله وعن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أتي بالبراق ليلة أسري به ملجما مسرجا أو كما قال أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters, and youngsters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, our Creator, our Sustainer, the only one entitled to worship, and we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. Occurrences and events that are extraordinary or out of the norm are generally those that bring amazement to the human being. For example, if we open the Guinness World Records and we see some of the extraordinary things that people do, whether it be the amount of strength one has to pull a vehicle with their own hands or slice an apple in midair, so on and so forth, it's an extraordinary occurrence. It's an extraordinary event which is not normal. And this is what brings amazement, and this is what brings the astonishment, and also the amazement that brings the understanding that this is not ordinary. When we look at one of the greatest extraordinary events that has ever occurred to any human being, that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this event is known as Mi'raj, is known as Isra wal Mi'raj. It was the ascension of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam up to the heavens and beyond. Now, when we look at this event, as ulama and scholars say, لا نبي مرسل ولا ملك مقرب, that there was no other prophet that was ever blessed with such a miracle, nor was there any angel that is near and dear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was ever blessed with this type of ascension or this type of extraordinary event. So indeed, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was blessed with this extraordinary miracle, and it is part of our aqidah, it is part of our belief that it is truthful, and one who rejects it, Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah, who is a scholar of theology, and he speaks about the elements of our creed that are necessary. We have to believe in Allah, we have to believe in angels, we have to believe in the Prophet, we have to believe in life after death. And amongst these items, he says, if one rejects Isra wal Mi'raj, the ascension of the Prophet ﷺ in a physical manner up to the heavens and beyond, then this will be damaging to their faith and their iman, their Islam is at question. So this is an extraordinary event, and it is beyond the norm of what a human being experiences. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, with this extraordinary event. When we study the narrations, the traditions, the statements of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and also those of the companions, they say that the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, was resting at the Kaaba, and the angel Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came with an animal known as Buraq, and the Prophet ﷺ said that the speed of this animal was like the speed of lightning. And this animal, accompanied with Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, took me to Masjid al-Aqsa, the blessed lands in Jerusalem. And there I met the prophets, I met the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. I led them in prayer. They all prayed behind me. And then I moved on to the Mi'raj, which is the ascension. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, I was taken to every level of the heavens, every level of the skies. And again, I met some of the prophets in these different levels. Then finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took me to the point where I was shown paradise and also the hellfire. the blessings and the bounties of paradise and some of the punishments and the devastations and the torments of the hellfire. And then the greatest blessing of all, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed some of the curtains of nur and divine light, and he was able to see and communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا كَذَبَ الْفُؤَادُ مَا رَأَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that what the heart of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, saw was not false, it was a reality. And then he was gifted with some gifts. Amongst those gifts is the salah and the prayer. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, returned. And all of this occurred within a fraction of a night. So it is our belief, it is our aqidah, that this is an event that did occur. It took place with the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and we must believe in it. Now, I want to take the few moments that are before me to take some reflections from this particular event so that we can internalize it and benefit from it as well on our daily lives, in our day-to-day activities. So the number one reflection or the reminder that we understand from this event is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever powerful. And we need to put our trust, we need to put our belief, our iman, our faith, our yaqeen, our conviction in this creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many times as human beings, we tend to be very proud and arrogant about our skills, about our intelligence, about our resources, and we feel that we can challenge any circumstance or any situation. But when we think of the Mi'raj event, we realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever powerful. What He can do is not, is in comparison to what we can do, is basically a vast difference. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has limitless powers, limitless resources. We have limits when it comes to our resources and our powers. If we don't eat for a day, we become half sick. If we don't sleep for a day or two, we become lethargic. We can't engage. We can't think. If we don't have drink or water for a day or two, we end up suffering. So this is how weak we are. And Allah reminds us in the Quran that you are a nutfa. You are made from a fluid of semen. And from that formed you as a human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. And then فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمٌ مُّبِينٌ. The human being becomes so arrogant that begins to argue even about the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the lessons or the reflections we can learn is that we have to put our firm faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the creator. He is the one that can do anything. We are constantly reminded in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Allah is ever powerful over everything. Allah tells us that He is kun fayakun. He says, be and it is. Abu Bakr al-Warraq, rahimahullah, great scholar of the pious predecessors, he says, al-yaqeenu milakul qalb, that when we have yaqeen and conviction, it is the essence of the creation of our hearts. And then he says, wabihi kamalul iman, when we have the proper conviction, we can attain the proper faith. If we have weak conviction and yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we question the Creator, if we have doubts about what the Creator and the Lord and the Almighty can do, then we are weak in our perspectives and we are on a very weak foundation and a very weak ground. Now, what does yaqeen entail? What does conviction entail? The ulama say it's a very vast subject and a topic, but in essence, we have to have knowledge that Allah has all the powers. Similarly, we have to have tawakkul and reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can take care of any matter. No one can challenge Him. We become weak, there is no weakness for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have resources, but Allah's resources are far better than our resources. He has no limits, we have limits, so on and so forth. And when we have this type of yaqeen, then there is no sadness or grief that will affect us. When we have this type of conviction, no matter how challenging the situation, we will never be despondent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will never lose hope. We will always find a way out of the challenging situations. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the one who has righteousness, who is fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has awe about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely take out a route for the person from the difficulty that they are facing. So when we look at the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, his seerah, his biography reminds us about this yaqeen and this conviction. The famous incident that we are all aware about, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, on his migration towards Madinatul Munawwara. It was a very challenging situation for him. There was an announcement and a declaration that was made that we want Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dead or alive. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he planned to go into the cave of Thawr. And there he is with his friend Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And the situation is that the armies are out, they're searching for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu notices that the army has come up to the entrance of the cave. And he's trembling, and he's shaking, and he's fearful. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, addresses Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and he says, مَا ظَنُّكَ بِإِثْنَيْنِ اللَّهُ ثَالِثَهُمَا. That what is your situation, that you're fearful, it's natural to be fearful, but remind yourself that we are two here as human beings, but the third being that is always with us is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ulama say that when we have firm conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have yaqeen and conviction in the powers and the might of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we'll always adopt the right path. We'll do whatever it takes to make the right choices. And when we make the right choices, Allah's blessings will be with us. To hide in a cave, if someone has committed a crime and is hiding in a cave, that's wrong. If someone has murdered someone and then is hiding in a cave, it's wrong. So this person may have yaqeen in the powers of Allah, but is disobeying the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here the situation was, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was hiding in a cave, but he had not disobeyed Allah. The companion Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had firm conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he hadn't disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we have firm conviction in Allah, then we will be motivated to do the right thing, and then we will realize, even in the bad situation and a difficulty or a problem or an issue, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide relief sooner or later. So this is part of the reflections, this is part of the lessons that we can learn from this great event of Isra and Mi'raj. The second point that I want to make reference to from this event is that when we study when this event was blessed to the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, we will find that it was after difficulty upon difficulty, challenge upon challenge. Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, for approximately 12 to 13 years, was engaged in da'wah and telling the people of Mecca that don't worship idols, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is your creator. And don't engage in forgery and false transactions that hurts people and deceive, it's full of deception, etc. Engage in moral activities. You're doing business, but be truthful in your business. You have family, then fulfill the rights of everyone in regards to the family. You are in the community, recognize everyone's position and show respect for everyone in the community. So this was the message of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. But they were arrogant and they were very proud of their positions. They were very forceful of their views, and they denied Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was in a state of somewhat of a stress. He was in a position where he felt that no one is embracing my message. There are very few people who are accepting what I have to say. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, traveled to Ta'if. He said, perhaps they might listen to my message. But over there as well, we know that It was a very difficult situation. They expelled him from the town in a very terrible situation where he became unconscious. He lost his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. She was an emotional support for the Prophet ﷺ. The uncle of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, Abu Talib, who protected the Prophet ﷺ from many individuals who were in positions of authority, in positions of the parliament or the government of Makkah al-Mukarramah and the region. He was the pillar for support for the Prophet ﷺ, to defend the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. So he was in a very difficult situation where he was almost losing hope. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then awarded him with this great event of Isra wal Mi'raj. And Allah took him up to the heavens. And this brought more conviction and more hope in the life of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. What's the lesson that we learn? That we may be at the point of what we call the last straw. Or we feel that this is a sickness that has destroyed my life. Or this is a family issue that is causing tremendous stress upon me. Or this is an economical situation that I'm facing, that I'm feeling that there's no way out of this. We reach a point where we begin to lose hope. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in the Quran, and this event is also, this mi'raj is also a reminder for us that inna ma'al usri yusra, with every difficulty there is ease. Sayaj'alullahu ba'da usri yusra. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always bring about ease after a difficult circumstance and a situation. So we learn from this event that we never lose hope, rather we put our full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are reminded through this event that Allah's mercy is always there for us, even if we face difficulty in circumstances and situations. The final reflection from this event is that we should have firm conviction that Islam is a truthful religion. And we're living in a time where Islam is being put on the table of discussion. Islam is being attacked from all sides. People are questioning, intellectuals, scientists, environmentalists, people of the government, you know, the average child that goes to school is being bombarded with questions in regards to Islam, etc. And it seems that we are in a position where we feel that is Islam really the truthful religion? So Mi'raj reminds us that Islam is the truthful religion. How is that? The ulama explain, the scholars of Islam explain that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, Allah awarded him with the ascension. Allah could have took him right from the Kaaba, right from where he was in Mecca, and taking him up to the heavens. What was the purpose of taking the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, to Jerusalem in Masjid al-Aqsa, and then from there up to the heavens? So amongst the reasons the scholars, one of the points that they write is that the reason was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to give this message that Islam is a truthful religion. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is a truthful prophet. So by going to Masjid al-Aqsa, Masjid al-Aqsa was the refuge for many prophets. The Banu Israel, the Israelites, many of the prophets, they came from this chain of Banu Israel, from the children of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. And they belong to this specific region. So by taking the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him there, it showed that there's a connection between these religions and these prophets and the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. The other point that they specify here is that the Prophet ﷺ was made to lead the prayer. He led the prayer for all the prophets. All the prophets, they followed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in prayer. So this was an indirect message that if we are alive with the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, in reality, then we would also follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has mentioned at one occasion, Umar radiallahu anhu was studying the Torah and he was hearing some of the stories of the previous prophets from the Jewish community. And he came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, O Prophet of Allah, I hear some stories from these people and I would like to write some of them down so that we can also talk and discuss about them. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, applauded his efforts, but then he said, look, whatever is mentioned in those books, the truth of those messages are summarized in the Holy Quran. And then he gave him a reminder. He said, if Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was alive, لو كان موسى حيا, if the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was alive today, then ما وسعه إلا اتباعي, he would also follow my message. And when the Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam returns, and a lot of people ask about this, when is Jesus returning? When is Isa alayhi salatu wasalam returning? There are some groups who claim to say they are Muslims and they say Isa alayhi salatu wasalam already came. This is an incorrect belief. The Quran testifies and the hadith makes it very clear that the Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, it's the Christian community and the Muslim community who believe that the Messiah to come is none other than Isa ibn Maryam, is none other than Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Even when he comes, he's gonna come as a follower of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will be a prophet. He has the crown of the prophet on his head. He's a prophet. But his prophethood, his teachings will not apply. He will follow the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So by taking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Masjid al-Aqsa and making him lead the prayer for all the prophets, it was an indication that all the prophets agree. All these messengers agree that Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, is a truthful prophet. And the deen that has come to us has come from the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, via the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this should give us confidence. Whenever we hear about the Mi'raj or the Ascension or the Isra of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it should give us the reinforcement that we should be confident that this is a truthful religion. This is the deen of Islam. And recently, I'm sure some of you heard about the survey and the findings of the survey that was conducted by the Environix Institute, and it was also published on the CBC, that the Canadian Muslims, generally what people say about them is not a reality. People say that Muslims are backward. People say that there are terrorists amongst the Canadian Muslims, etc., and they're not part of the Canadian society. But the survey, this is hardcore data. This is analysis. This is information that is concluded after a thorough survey, where it proves that Muslims are engaging in the community. They have similar concerns like any other Canadian citizen. They are equally Canadian. They are concerned about their religion. They are concerned about the climate and the environment, and about jobs and about health and about medicine. Everything that a human being, everything that decent citizens of a country would be concerned about, that what Muslims are also, the Canadian Muslims are also concerned about those same issues. So it is a reassurance that Islam is truthful. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said one of the signs of the Day of Judgment, that it will be difficult to practice Islam. But the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, hold firmly onto your Islam. This will give you the contentment. This will give you the hope. This will give you the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no doubt we are living in challenging times, but this occasion of Rajab is a reminder that the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. The occasion and the event of Isra wal Mi'raj is a reminder that we need to have firm belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we need to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always bring about ease after our difficulties. And we need to have the reassurance and the confidence in our religion. And by doing so, we will be amongst those who are succeeding both in this world as well as the hereafter. So we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with the true reflections of the occasion of Mi'raj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with all the mercy that descends in the month of Rajab. And as the Prophet ﷺ would make dua, Allahumma barik lana fi Rajab wa Sha'ban. O Allah, bless us with the blessings of both the month of Rajab and Sha'ban, wa balighna Ramadan. O Allah, take us to Ramadan. So Ramadan is numbered days away, so we need to have this anticipation for the month of Ramadan. We pray that Allah give us the mercy and keep us alive till the month of Ramadan, so that we can benefit from the blessings of the month of Ramadan. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our communities, bless our families. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who are confident on the deen of Islam. And we pray that Allah give us the best of rewards and blessings in this world as well as in the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. The announcements this week, alhamdulillah, the collection last Friday for the Islamic Foundation of Toronto was $2,140. Jazakumullah khairan for everyone's contributions and generosity. Today's collection, before and after the prayers, is exclusively for the Islamic Foundation of Toronto to meet the expenses related to the Friday police officers, the parking attendants, parking lot rentals, utilities, and maintenance of the masjid. We're requesting everyone to donate generously. Jazakumullah khairan. We're requesting the volunteers as well who are assigned for the IFT line collection to kindly proceed now. As you are all aware, the Islamic Foundation's Syrian Refugees Initiative is underway, and we have been announcing the updates and the progress continuously. Alhamdulillah, you will be glad to know that more than 200 families have been sponsored, and now our target is 600 families, inshallah. The situation is getting worse for the refugees in Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan, and we need to help the distressed families on an urgent basis. We have identified a large number of single-parent families who have lost their dear ones in the war and would like to help more and more families to come to Canada for a better life. We urge you, brothers and sisters, to be part of this initiative and let us demonstrate our empathy and